Good evening. I'm doing okay. I made it through the weekend.
Hello,
how you doing, Mikey?
We're doing good. Hello. Did you have a good time?
We did.
Well, it's nice that way. Good evening, how are you, sir?
Doing okay, how are you? That's good.
You're not more Dory. I can't hear you, so you still have business.
I've been busy. Yeah, it is. It's picked up in the last few weeks. Business has kind of been going like the weather. Get a little cold, then it starts getting warm again. A little cold. And so, yeah, it's starting to come around. It's always good. Yes, he is. That's an understatement. I'm waiting for him. You know,
I'm going to go to the
what I'm wanting you to come back.
But I have to start to work on the attention. I'm not sure you can afford to do all that.
I know what my plan is. And you take all of the cash that they've got on hand and you donate it someplace where it can be used. My account is Lori. She lived here for years. She worked for me for 3 years. She moved back to Reading to be close to her mom. Her dad was gone. And so she's continuing to do my accounting work back there. She sends me an email this morning. She says my brother was in the LA News last night. She sent me a link. She says it was really a rough weekend for the family. I'm like, what the hell?
What'd you lose, sir?
Says house explodes on fire. They find a drug lab, a secret drug lab in the house. His picture's there. And I'm like, holy shit, you've got to be kidding me.
Did my wife get hold of you yet?
Oh, it wasn't yet?
No, it was next door to it. But I mean, the way she put it, I met him. You know, the guy seemed like a pretty smart cookie, you know. And, but they were making, they had to be broken. There wasn't, because they were making that. They were cooking downtown at the restaurants. And so something, they must have got a little, they did something wrong. And I mean, there was only 3 bottles left standing. Oh yeah, 2 guys that were in there. No, they said they were in the hospital for extensive burns on their face and all the arms.
They don't need your pot. Good evening.
Good evening.
He must be back. He's back there talking.
Oh, okay.
He's still got 4 or 5 minutes.
I can't Sir Chapman,
Sergeant Chapman.
I guess he's like enlisted guys. Oh, yeah. Like to be called officers.
Oh, no.
I always thought officer was generic.
Is that right? Well, officer is a non-written.
It must be non-commissioned.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah, I don't know how all that works.
Yeah, I'm not a cop, so. All you understand at my house, she's a captain and I'm a chief. And I'm not her chief.
You're a master chief, but you're not.
Nope. Yeah, she's a captain.
She's the captain, yeah.
I understand that relationship.
When my captain reinstated me in second class, he said, is there any chance you can get one of that strike for me?
Nothing.
So you randomly.
I just, something about those guys.
Put the cuffs on and keep me in.
As long as you keep me out at sea, I won't get in trouble.
Yeah. If it gets worse, I will. If I really start feeling bad, I ate a little and took some stuff, and that makes it's everything.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Stomach, head, throat.
It was turning into talking to
you. Yeah, my daughter.
Okay,
my
you guys ready?
I'll never be any more so.
That's good to hear. That's good to hear. Jamie and Liz, you guys ready? Ready?
Okay.
And you've got the invitation tonight. We'll go ahead and call this meeting to order. Please rise and remove your hats for the invocation.
Heavenly Father, hear our prayers. Thank you for the opportunity to serve the citizens of the town of Chino Valley on this council. Let us look forward to pursuing golden opportunities instead of dwelling on well-intentioned imperfections of our predecessors. Help us to be worthy of your trust and the trust of others as we perform our duties. Give us the insight to study and learn from past choices and the determination to take responsibilities for our actions. Let us always be humble enough to seek the counsel of others when facing difficult situations. Grant us the wisdom to know when change is needed and the strength to make judicious decisions in a timely manner. Give us the ability to listen to our community and to communicate our thoughts and actions in a positive and productive manner. Let us always be proactive in recognizing others for their contribution to the health and prosperity of this community and its citizens. Bless this council and our community. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. May we have the roll call.
Good evening. We'll start with Councilmember McKee.
Here.
Councilmember Turner.
Here.
Councilmember Wojcik.
Here.
Councilmember Best.
Here.
Vice Mayor Croft.
Here.
And Mayor Marley.
Here. Introductions, presentations, and proclamations. We don't have any. Our call to the public is next. Call to the public is an opportunity for the public to address the council concerning a subject that is not on the agenda. Public comment is encouraged. Individuals are limited to speak for 3 minutes. Total time for call to the public may be up to 30 minutes per meeting. Council action taken as a result of public comment will be limited to directing staff to study the matter, scheduling the matter for further consideration and decision at a later date, or responding to criticism. Do we have anyone for call to the public? Yes, ma'am. Please come up.
Good evening, Mayor Marley, Vice Mayor Croft, council members, and city employees. My name is Edith Spain. I'm a resident of Chino Valley. The trial and conviction of Councilwoman Hatch is complete. The prepared resignation that she was not allowed time to read was submitted the night of her final trial. You will now handpick a replacement whose tenure will last until November of 2016. If you succeed in recalling council members McKee and Wojcik, the Chino Valley Council will become your dream council, a one-party system, I might add. Well done. But something was missing in the process. Linda Hatch, elected by the citizens of Chino Valley, never got her day in court. Each time she requested that opportunity, she was voted down. The night of her demise, she and her attorney were surprised by a 10-minute time limit. The mayor, knowing ahead of time about the time limit, was able to include all of his talking points. Not so for Linda and her counsel. Because of your successful censor strategies, I remain unclear regarding what Linda Hatch did to cause the court. If she was guilty, so be it. However, I will never know because neither she nor her counsel was allowed to present their facts. I voted for Linda Hatch because of her sincere desire to make an honest town out of Chino Valley. Her Peace Corps service, her advanced education, and an interesting class she teaches at Yavapai College contributed to my choice. The class, Ethics in the Media and Politics. Did she know too much? Too much about ethics? Too much about the Chino Valley backstories? I'll never know, because she was never allowed her day in court. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else for call to the public? Call to the public is now closed. Response to the public. Response to the public is an opportunity for the mayor to inform the public about how town officials addressed matters raised during call to the public at a previous meeting. And we had nothing raised at a previous meeting, so we'll continue onward. Current event summaries and reports. This item is for information only. The mayor, any council member, or town manager may present a brief summary or report of current events or ask a staff member to provide the same. Presentation on information requested by the mayor and council will be made and questions answered. No action will be taken. Do we have any reports on this side of the dais for council? Any reports on this side? Okay. I would like to thank our town's citizens. As many of you know, our town clerk's office was inundated for the past 3 months with records requests, and I wanted to thank our citizens. Many of our citizens came in over this last week and withdrew their records requests, so hopefully our town clerks can see some daylight soon. The second item I'd like to address is that of the first annual Honor and Remember, the Honoring the Military Fallen Heroes on Memorial Day. Excuse me, someone passed me a note. This is sort of like the old way people did Facebook. Okay. All right.
That would be from me.
That would be from you.
On an earlier question.
Okay, there's something on your face. No, I'm just kidding. Anyway, I'll read that later. Thank you. Memorial Day 2015. I was asked to speak at a Memorial Day service over in Prescott Valley yesterday, and was really an honor to be a part of that. We were honoring Arizona's fallen, and it was put on by the Gold Star parents who had lost children in combat and their families. And this is a part of what I read at that event yesterday. I had several folks ask me for copies of it, and so I thought I would share part of it with you. The men and women who voluntarily serve in our armed forces exemplify a character trait that has become increasingly rare in our culture today. The ability to see oneself as a part of something greater. To be able to say, it's not about me, it's about my country. It's not about my dreams and my desires. It's about honor and duty. A willingness to endure hardship and danger in order that our loved ones might enjoy safety and peace is difficult to find in today's society, but it's alive and well in our nation's armed forces. It saddens me to see the media glorify those who would never lift a finger to defend their country, yet they shake their fist and demand their rights as Americans. Standing in stark contrast are those true patriots who quietly step forward when duty calls and say, "Here am I, send me." The Lord Jesus Christ, in speaking of his coming death, said, "Greater love hath no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friends." Today we honor those who have done just that. They've laid down their lives for their friends, for their God, and for their country. Let us continue to honor their memory by striving to preserve this great nation, which is, even as we speak, under attack by enemies both foreign and domestic. Let us stand strong against those who would destroy our nation, our Constitution, and the very fabric of the American people.
Have the vets stand up.
Yes, sir.
Have the vets stand up.
All right. Could our vets stand up, please? All our veterans, if you would.
All right. We've got a bunch of them.
Thank you. Our next item is a status report by Town Manager Robert Smith regarding town accomplishments and current or upcoming projects. Mr. Smith, did you have anything?
Mayor, I'd like to cede my time to two department heads to provide some updates on current events here in town.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Just wanted to give you a little update on a couple of things that are happening. First off, tax day is done, and the Senior Center prepared over 422 federal tax returns for people in Chino Valley, as well as assisted 63 seniors in filing the Arizona property tax credit. So those are for low-income seniors, so that was a good deal. I wanted to give you a heads up that the Senior Center will be closing a couple days a week starting June 6th they're going to be doing some remodeling. The funds are coming from what is called the Herman Fund. It was an endowment that was left to the Senior Center back in 1995, about $103,000. We only have about 30-some thousand of that left. Different amounts were used for, like, the parking lot, other improvements that have been done to the Senior Center over the years. So we have about $30,000 left. We're going to get a new floor first put in, and then come about July sometime, we're going to get a patio put in and some French doors and a couple other things. But first off, they're going to be closed for eating out in Memory Park, I should say. We'll still do our Meals and Wheels program, and then have just meals 3 days a week out in the park. So that'll be on June 6th. And then also on June 6th, we have on the county agenda, we have a contract with the county for GIS services. So I just wanted to let you know that was going to be coming up. It is for $11,000, and it's for our next year's budget. And it's in the manager's spending level, so it won't be coming before the council. And it allows us access to the county's GIS database, and it's it'll allow our development services department and our engineering department to access their database. So a chunk of that money is for actual the part buy into their software, and then a small portion for their GIS support. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Are we allowed to ask questions?
I believe we're not supposed to ask questions during the current events. So
the answer is no question.
The answer is no. We used to ask questions during current events, and now we don't.
Okay, just no discussion.
Okay.
No action will be taken.
Okay,
questions can be answered.
Okay, hang tight for just a second. Ms. Lewis, you had brought us back from Phoenix this during current events. There can be no discussion during the current events. Is that correct? I had that. You handed it to me when you came back from your meeting with the Attorney General's office.
I thought that was regarding call to the public.
It says right at the top, current events. There can be no discussion during current events. Okay.
Because we never made any change to this.
Okay, okay. All right, we will try and...
What is the answer?
I'm going to say no, because that was our last thing that Ms. Lewis had said. Hang on for a second. I'll ask Ms. Smiley. Ms. Smiley, the Attorney General says we're not to discuss things during current events. I'm good in orange if you want me to go ahead. I'm just kidding. No. Yes, ma'am.
I'm not aware of the Attorney General's opinion on that. I wouldn't go against the Attorney General's opinion, but I would say that if a council member had a question, they could ask the question and have the question answered, as long as there was no discussion back and forth.
Okay. As long as there's no discussion. Well, you had a question.
I guess my real question is, was that considered to be a current event? That's more like a staff report. Does that fall under the same category?
It's under item 5, current events, status report. Okay. But we can have no discussion, but we can have a question. Did you have a question?
I did.
Okay.
I forgot what it was. Oh, just kidding.
Yes, sir.
No, the question was, I had heard that the senior center... Hello? The senior center was going to be closed continuously from like the 8th of June until the 28th of June. Now I just hear that it's going to only be a couple days a week, and I'm confused as to what the real story might be.
Well, they have to be open for Meals on Wheels. That's required under our contract for NACOG. Not open, they have to be able to serve Meals on Wheels. So Monday, I believe it's Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, they're going to serve meals over in Memory Park for 2 weeks. It's going to take 2 weeks to get the floors done. After that, people can come back into the senior center. When they do the other renovations, we don't have to close.
Memory Park being that little cabana out there in the middle of no man's land? Not the senior center building itself?
Not in the building, no, because the whole floors are going to be done.
Okay.
And so right across the parking lot in Memory Park, we're going to have picnic tables over there. We anticipate, yes, the participation will be down, but that's the only way we can get the floors done.
Especially if it rains, I guess, huh?
Okay. Excellent. Did that answer your question, sir? Okay, thank you. I believe...
Did you take my agenda?
Mr. Krippman, did you have a report?
Yeah, Robert asked me to stand up and give a little status report on the chip seal program. Last week, we completed the chip seal program for Bumblebee, Damien Loop, Karen Acres, and Center Street. Center Street is now opened all the way back to Railroad. We've gotten a few comments back from folks who use it, and it's generally been very, very well received. Right now, the chip seal looks kind of a grayish color. Right now, it's scheduled for June 22nd. The contractor is looking at moving that up to possibly June 1st and 2nd. So if they can schedule it and fit it into their schedule, they're going to come in and do what's called a fog seal over the top of it. And that will actually basically put an oil product on top of the roadway, making it look black. Still want everybody to recognize this is only chip seal. It's not full-on asphalt, so be gentle on the roads. But they're all done, and it was went off without a hitch.
Okay, thank you very much. Before we close out current event summaries and reports, Mr. Smith, this is the sheet that I received from Ms. Lewis at one of our agenda meetings from her training down in Phoenix. If you wish, I can get you a copy of this, but we need to have all of us on the same page on that. Okay, thank you. Next item is consent agenda. All those items listed below are considered to be routine and may be enacted by one motion. Any council member may request to remove an item from the consent agenda to be considered and discussed separately. Does anyone wish to remove any consent agenda items? No? Okay, Ms. Lewis.
Item A, consideration and possible action to accept the April 28th, 2015 regular meeting minutes. B, consideration and possible action to adopt resolution number 15-1058, approving the proposed statements and estimates of expenses of the Town of Chino Valley Street Lighting Improvement Districts for fiscal year 2015-2016 pursuant to Section 48-616, Arizona Revised Statutes as amended, setting a date for public hearing on the proposed statements and estimates as approved, and providing for notice of the hearing and publication of the proposed statements and estimates of the expenses of the district, which shall be provided for by the levy and collection of ad valorem taxes on the assessed value of all the real and personal property in the districts. And C is consideration and possible action to authorize the mayor to sign a letter of commitment with the Economic Development Administration in the amount of $85,000. The match of $85,000 is budgeted in the Capital Improvement Fund for fiscal year 2012-2016.
All right. The chair would entertain a motion.
Motion to approve consent agenda items A, B, and C.
Second it.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Moving on to action items. Before we enter into our action items, I would like to move that we recess for 5 minutes. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed, same sign.
Okay. Aye.
All right. Well, motion sort of carries. All right. We're going to take 5 minutes and be right back.
I didn't ask him. He's leaving. You like to be here?
Oh, well.
Mother Nature's calling. You got to go. He's got the apples. He's got the apples. Well, that's not what I thought. Well, yeah, I would think so, only because you're one of many votes. I mean,
but the contingency applies to my speech. And I'm going to get the problem.
Well, I don't blame you, but I mean, it's not like it was done just for Don.
No, I understand that. I understand that, but the question is counting votes.
But. So where are you working? You're in town this time?
I've been in town. I'm going to be back down at Hickman's here in about 2 weeks. They're starting another project down there. I've got a little bit of work down south in the Phoenix area. And I'm still waiting to see whether we're going to get that project. When I went down last week to make sure the Phoenix a new booster station. They've got the 8-story hotel, and so they have to boost the community, you know, the water to, you know, and the system again. There's 35 years old. It's getting pretty. And people, things have quit working, like, you know, they're balancing that, so they've just bypassed them instead of fixing them.
That makes a lot of noise.
And plus, they're wasting a lot of electricity. Those pumps just go up at low usage times. They just come up to dead head pressure and then run. You know, they never shut down. So.
Is Hickman having any trouble with all the diseases that...
Oh, yeah. Well, that's this project. Right now, they bought another 50 acres of ground. They're going to have their maintenance department there too eventually. But they're actually putting in a full-on truck wash for disinfection. Every truck that comes in will be disinfected before it goes to the farm, and then when it comes off of their farm, it will be disinfected again before it hits the roadway. So they say, we're not letting anything in, and we're not going to be accused of having anything going on.
That's
But they said since this has come about, it's never going to go away as far as the precaution.
All right. You guys ready?
What?
Okay, we're back in session. Action item A, consideration and possible action to ratify council's action on September 9th, 2014 to dismiss Robert McCauley from the Planning and Zoning Commission or to overturn the council's September 9th, 2014 action.
Mayor, I'd like to recuse myself.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Lewis, I would like to have it on record that I am exiting council chambers as
okay.
required.
We'll have a form for you to fill out later.
Okay. All right. Our first order of business is on page 31 of our council members' packet. PNZ Overview, Commissioner Removal 2014. On September 2nd, 2014, the Chino Valley Police Department began an investigation into what appeared to be a violation of Arizona's conflict of interest laws by two members of the Chino Valley Planning and Zoning Commission. Knowingly violating conflict of interest laws can result in a Class 6 felony. As the investigation was drawing to a close, Chino Valley Mayor Chris Marley received a status report on September 9th from the Chino Valley Police Department indicating that although the investigation had not been completed, preliminary findings indicated that there had been a violation of state statute and that criminal charges may be forthcoming, thus sending the case to the Yavapai County Attorney's Office. At that time, there was an upcoming planning and zoning hearing scheduled for September 16th, which involved a possible ruling on the property, which was part of the ongoing investigation. Since there was no provision in the Unified Development Ordinance for suspension of commission members during the course of an investigation, and the county attorney's office had not yet met to discuss the case, the Chino Valley Town Council voted after executive session on September 9th, 2014, to remove the two commissioners pursuant to Town Code Section 30.071. Council later received notification that one of the commissioners, Mr. Edmonds, had sent in a letter of resignation effective September 4th, which was prior to the executive session. Since neither the town code nor the Unified Development Ordinance requires a hearing prior to the dismissal of a commissioner, the town's attorney determined that according to Town Code Section 30.071, commissioners serve at the pleasure of the council, and therefore an executive session with a 24-hour notice to the commissioner was all that was required. The town's Unified Development Ordinance Section 1.4.1 states that members of the commission may be removed by the council for inefficiency, neglect of duty, excessive absenteeism, or malfeasance in office subsequent to an executive session. On November 3rd, the Chino Valley Police Department received notice from the Yavapai County Attorney's Office that although Mr. Edmonds and Mr. McCauley had publicly indicated that they had an interest in the matters before the commission, there was no evidence that their votes conferred a direct economic benefit on either person. Therefore, their conduct did not rise to the level of a criminal violation of the statute. Since the Chino Valley Town Council voted after an executive session to remove Mr. McCauley from his position without giving him the required 24-hour notice, the mayor will schedule an executive session for May 12th with the required 24-hour notice, prior notice to Mr. McCauley in order to discuss his earlier dismissal. As it is now May the 26th, and we are finally getting this addressed, that paper that I just read was an answer to Mr. McCauley's call to the public some time back. At this point, I wish to publicly apologize to Mr. McCauley for not getting his 24-hour notice to him prior to his dismissal. What broke down in the system is not what matters here. What is important is that Mr. McCauley was not notified. As the chief executive officer of the town of Chino Valley, I personally am responsible for that failure. Now, although a public hearing is not required, I have asked that Mr. McCauley be given 10 minutes to address the council. Mr. McCauley has requested 15 minutes, and as chair, I have granted it. Before I ask Mr. McCauley to address the council, I was going to read a short excerpt from Robert's Rules of Order, and I need to go ahead and read that since that's a part of the process here. Please bear with me for a moment. This is called abstaining from voting on a question of direct personal interest. No member should vote on a question in which he has a direct personal or pecuniary interest not common to other members of the organization. For example, if a motion proposes that the organization enter into a contract with a commercial firm of which a member of the organization is an officer and from which contract he would derive personal pecuniary profit, the member should abstain from voting on the motion. However, no member can be compelled to refrain from voting in such circumstances. Ms. McKee has stepped away from the dais, and so is there anyone else who needs to step away from the dais? Okay, we will then proceed. Mr. McCauley, you will be given 15 minutes. Our vice mayor has a timer and will give you the 1 minute warning. Please stay on the subject. Please observe the rules of propriety listed in your council meeting information sheet. And please remember that you're addressing the council, not the audience. You have 15 minutes, sir.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I relinquish my time to Jeff Sparks, my attorney.
Okay. Yes, sir.
As Mr. McCauley said, my name is Jeff Sparks. I'm a local attorney, and I'm here on behalf of Mr. McCauley. And on, or in that regard, concerning the removal back in September 2014, from the Planning and Zoning Commission of the town of Chino Valley. I want to discuss three basic things. One are the facts. Two, it's going to be the rule of law. What controls all this? Though I think from what I heard from Mayor Marley, the conclusion may be foregone. And I appreciate that. Mm-hmm. The third item would be your duty. And just not your duty to Mr. McCauley, but the duty to yourselves, to the law, to your community. Now, I saw a couple of weeks ago Councilman Turner make some comments. And it concerned me because, Councilman Turner, you seem to have some angst about a presentation by an attorney representing Councilperson Hatch at the time. You made comments about wordsmithing and the use of legalese and how facts can be manipulated.
Excuse I bring that me, up. Sir, please. Be real careful about this. If this is ending into a personal attack,
it is not at all
against. All right. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Because my next statement will address that.
Okay.
Because of what I heard with the comments, I want to make it very clear to this council: we're only going to talk about facts. We're not going to talk about innuendo. We're not going to talk about rumor. We're not going to talk about speculation. And yep, there could be a lot of it involved in this matter. But we're not going there because we don't need to. But I just wanted to give you my assurance that we're just going to be talking about facts. We're also going to be talking about duty a little bit. And when y'all took office, and I say y'all because I spent a lot of time in Texas, so I apologize, but I did grow up in Prescott. When you took office, you took an oath. Your oath required you to abide by the Constitution of the United States, the Constitution of the state of Arizona, the laws of the state of Arizona, the rules, regulations, and ordinances of the town of Chino Valley. You also swore that you would do that impartially, and that you'd be responsible in making those decisions to all people, and that includes Mr. McCauley. So let's talk about the facts. Back in June of 2013, Chino Valley Planning and Zoning was doing some votes on some property. And that was, they took votes in June, they took votes in July. And for some reason, Ms. Smiley, your town attorney, generated an email about conflict of interest. Well, the votes took place, and everything went in due course. And then in August of 2014, more than a year later, Ms. Smiley generated, or a document was generated from Ms. Smiley's office concerning conflict of interest again. And let me point out, Ms. Smiley did not, in that document, indicate or implicate Mr. McCauley had violated any criminal or civil laws. So, approximately 2 weeks after that document about conflict of interest was generated, there was a person by the name of Mayor Marley, and he proceeded to contact the Chino Valley Police Department. And he had concerns and wanted to make a complaint about conflict of interest by Commissioner McCauley at the time. And so he filed a complaint. And the police of Chino Valley, they did what they're supposed to do.
Please address the council, sir. Thank you.
Thank you for the reminder.
You bet. You're from Texas. That's okay.
No, I'm from Prescott.
Okay.
I just spent some time out there.
Okay.
Regardless, Mayor Marley filed a complaint. It was investigated as it should be. That complaint was filed on September 2nd, 2014. The investigation was completed, as noted by your recitation of the document you were reading from, Mayor. And the ultimate conclusion, after it was given to the Yavapai County Attorney's Office, there was no evidence of criminal violation. That letter, and I think this is important, exonerated this man from the innuendos, the implication, the supposition that he committed a criminal offense. They should have done it. Everything should have been over with. But what happened between September 2nd and November 3rd, 2014, when the letter was generated by the Yavapai County Attorney's Office? An executive session was scheduled 6 days after the filing of the complaint by Mayor Marley. 7 days after filing the complaint by Mayor Marley, Commissioner McCauley was removed. Fine and well? No, not at all. Notice was not given. It's required by law to give at least 24 hours notice. And because notice was not given, Mr. McCauley was denied his rights. He couldn't demand of the council for a public meeting or a public hearing. That's what we call in the legal business the lack of due process. Due process is the cornerstone, one of the cornerstones, of the United States Constitution, as well as the Arizona Constitution. In this case, it was denied. Then there was an interesting twist. Commissioner McCauley was removed because of this supposed conflict of interest, which was later found not to be a criminal issue. Mm-hmm. But guess what? It's not a civil issue either. Because guess whose attorneys filed legal documents in a lawsuit claiming no such conflict exists at a civil level? The town of Chino Valley. You're all aware that you were sued by La Cara Trust. Remember that? And when you were sued, one of the counts was about this conflict of interest. Your attorneys filed on the record a judicial document denying any conflict of interest. So now we know civilly the town's position, unless the town wishes to speak out of both sides of its mouth. I don't mean that as an insult, but more of an analogy. There is no civil conflict as expressed by your own lawyers, and there's no criminal conduct as expressed by our county attorney. And then you brought up the acknowledgement in the last paragraph of that planning and zoning overview that you didn't give the required notice. And we all know that notice is required by law. It's required under section ARS, that's Arizona Revised Civil Statutes, 38-431.03. I won't keep track of all these numbers. It's also required by the agency handbook that you have, section 7.6.5, 7.6.7. And it applies to, and did apply to, Commissioner McCauley at the time because of how he was an appointed member, public officer of Planning and Zoning Commission. And that's expressed in the UDO 1.41 and under your agency handbook of 2.2. At the time, and I realize that there's a modification in the process of how to remove folks, but at the time, the UDO that affected Commissioner McCauley allowed for removal for four instances, and you discussed those when talking about that letter. Well, when we find out that there was no civil conflict of interest, there's no criminal conflict of interest, there cannot be, and that was the basis of the removal, you cannot go back now and say there was malfeasance of some sort because that wasn't the issue. There was not inefficiency because that's not the issue. There was not neglected duty, that's not the issue, nor absenteeism. Somebody was upset about how people were voting. I get it. But you guys and ladies that voted at the time have to realize we have to follow the law. It wasn't followed. And because it wasn't followed, unfortunately, each and every person that voted in that executive session did not uphold the oath they took to be sitting where you're sitting today. You can rectify that. You can do the honorable thing. You can do the legal thing. You can reinstate Mr. McCauley as Commissioner McCauley. It's required by law. It's required by due process. There is only one path to take that will comply with the law, that will comply with the honor, that will comply with your duty. And that's to stand up and say, we made a mistake. We did it wrong. We have to reinstate Mr. McCauley as Commissioner McCauley. Do your duty, please. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. McCauley, it's obvious from the police investigative report that you did make an informed decision after receiving input from our town attorney on September 9th, 2014. Two members of the Chino Valley Town Council were absent, Councilmember Hatch and Councilmember McKee. The five remaining council members voted unanimously to remove you and Mr. Edmonds from Planning and Zoning Commission. Unless there's a motion to rescind, approved by a majority of the town council, the September 9th, 2014 council decision stands. Is there a motion to rescind? And if there is, I will need a second for it. Would you please speak in the microphone?
I move that we rescind the decision back in September, whatever the date was.
Okay. Do we have a second? Okay, motion fails for lack of second. Was there a second coming? Okay. Motion fails for lack of second. The September 9th, 2014 council decision stands. Thank you. Item 7B, consideration and possible action to approve resolution number 15-1059, adopting a tentative budget for the fiscal year 2015-2016. And proposed expenditure limitation for the same year in the amount of $23,937,400, setting the expenditure limit for fiscal year 2014-2015. Mr. Duffy.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. Tonight, we're here to adopt the tentative budget for fiscal year 15-16. As you know, setting the tentative budget sets the maximum amount the town can spend. And we can't spend a penny more, so this is a very important evening. It's the next step in our budget process. We're going to adopt Resolution 15-1059, if Council so desires, setting our tentative budget at $23,937,400. In your packet, I've included the official state forms, and the entire budget can be found on our website in the finance section under reports in Chino Valley or chinoaz.net, and it's labeled tentative budget. Since our study session, as you know, budget, we pretty much start that in January every year and begin working on it. We had our last study session on May 7th where we looked at the preliminary budget, the first pass out.
Excuse me, can we please keep the conversations to a minimum? Thank you. Yes, sir, go ahead.
We had the first pass out of the gate. Mm-hmm. After that study session, then our next step, of course, is the tentative budget, which we do tonight. And then on June 23rd, we'll also hold a public hearing and adopt the final budget. Since the preliminary budget that I presented to Council, we've done a little more work. We updated the revenue manual and projections. Some of the projections, like our building permits, are significantly up where we thought they were going to be. As you know, our first revenue manual we do really based on March data. So I waited till the end of April or early May, and we updated all those numbers. We added the additional grant match for the Rural Economic Development grant we just received, and we added a few new charts and made some formatting changes. But after all that, and we really didn't do much at all, our net change is we had a budget decrease of $12,000. Mm-hmm. So just a small minor changes. Some of the significant items, as we talked about in our study session, that the council had to deal with this year, that looking forward into this coming year's budget, is we did have a health insurance increase of 5%. Plus, we increased the dependent care contribution from 25% to 32%. That cost the town an additional $32,000. PSPRS, which is our police officers' retirement system, was up 1.6%, and that continues that trend of going up every year. It costs us about $8,000. We've added 2 full-time equivalents this year, a human resources director, and we've budgeted for a wastewater treatment plant operator, but we're not going to fill that until we definitely define the need for that position. And it'll be up to Ron and see how operating the new plan is, but we put it in there more of a placeholder just in case. And we'll bring it to council, too, before we authorize that position. We have a 1% cost of living increase, really to try to keep the employees' checks neutral with the dependent and health insurance coverage. We just try to keep it as neutral as possible. A couple of the big items that we have this year in the budget is the Prescott Water acquisition. We budgeted $4.5 million. We have the USDA refinance, which requires a new money project. That'll reduce our interest rate we're paying on our USDA bonds from 4.125% to hopefully very, very close to 2%, depending on the timing. Of course, that does require us to do a new project because WIFA, who we're going through, requires it. So we've added the Molly Ray Sewer Extension from Center Street for $500,000. Our impact fee funds are going after this budget year are zero. We've been using them up on projects, particularly in the road department. So we're planning on exhausting those funds totally by the end of this fiscal year. And as you know, last August, we quit assessing impact fees. Mm. Our HERF reserve funds are now exhausted. Over the last 3 years, we've been aggressively using the built-up reserves to put as much money on the roads as possible, as quickly as possible, defer the long-term maintenance costs. And after this year, those two are gone. So we're going to have to be looking at a different additional ways of funding the road improvements and that type of thing. We're also beginning the planning to address the capital asset shortfalls that we have. We're looking at all of our equipment, our buildings, and particularly our roads, and looking for new ways to finance those. This budget year was also completely a lot different in that we just didn't project 1 year forward. We projected 5 years. Now, we've been doing that, but what we did this year that's different is we made sure that projection was balanced. So we didn't just push stuff off and go, oh, yeah, we'll fix it next year. We really projected out the next 5 years and made sure that every fund balances. So we have a really good, solid financial plan to work with as we go in the future. Now, every year, we're going to make fine-tuned adjustments to that plan. But at least for right now, we know we're on the right path. Looking at the budgets last year versus this year, the column in the center is last year's budget. You can see that the general fund is just slightly up from $7.8 million to $8 million. Our special revenue funds, HERF, they're a little bit down, but essentially flat, a little bit less grant activity. Debt service is even. Capital project funds are quite a bit down, and that's because this year we did the sewer buy, or the wastewater treatment plant purchase, and we're not going to do that. And I've actually budgeted the Prescott Water acquisition in the enterprise funds, so that's why it's so much higher. But overall, we've come in from a budget of almost $30 million down to about $24 million. So it's a significant increase. Now understand, tonight we're setting our expenditure limitation, and we always put a little buffer in our capital improvement fund just in case we get a big $1.5 million grant that we didn't budget for that allows us to spend it. And the town has historically put a $2 million buffer in the revenue and expense. We put it in the capital improvement fund because typically that'd be for capital improvement dollars. So all in all, that and the capital is going to be about $24 million. And I'll briefly go through the funds. Our revenues in the general fund, when I last spoke to you, we thought we were only going to increase our fund balance by about $220,000. Well, after updating revenue estimates, we've got another about $50,000 than we thought we had even from the study session. And it's primarily because of building permits and just looking at the state share revenues. So this budget year, we had revenues of $7.6 million. We had expenses of $7.3 million. So we're going to have an excess funds or carryover funds of $326,000. We're recommending that we take $50,000 of that and put it in and transfer it to the HERF fund for next year to help supplement the roads budget. And that's essentially next year's budget of the general fund, $8 million, with an expense of $8,051,000, which is the $50,000 going to the HERF fund to keep it equal. But our fund balance will continue to increase by $273,000 approximately this year, which I think from my perspective is a healthy amount, you know, 1 or 2% of the budget, and that fund balance continues to grow every year. I think it's a smart, prudent thing for a community to do. We have some new transfers in. Last year we transferred $100,000, and these $100,000 in from the Capital Improvement Fund to support the police, and we transferred $10,000 from the Special Revenue Fund, which is the towing fees that the police department get. So last year we had transfers of $110,000. This year we've added $150,000 out of the Capital Improvement Fund to support the Aquatic Center. So now it's up to $260,000. Realize once we've done this, it's pretty sure we're going to continue that process year after year after year after year. So the HERF fund, as I said, we've pretty much used our fund balance as we planned on having an ending fund balance in the first column on the left there of $323,757. We're probably going to end up about $345,000. We haven't spent quite as much as we planned, but by the end of next year, we're at $226,000. And the reserve level for that fund, based on our financial policies, is about $215,000. So we've used up all the funds. And at the bottom of the chart, you can see that road material is going from $175,000 to $155,000. And as we know, that's not even close to what we need to maintain our roads in any shape or form. The Capital Improvement Fund, I'm going to go through this one in a little bit more detail than the others. We have our ongoing revenues next budget year of $3.4 million. That includes that $2 million buffer. We have the final transfers from the Road Impact Fee Funds of $529,000. A Yavapai drainage district project of $650,000. So we're bringing in about $4.6 million in capital in revenues. Honestly, though, it's $2.6 million. We're going to have department expenditures of $2,040,000, but really just the $40,000. And that's for the tower at the North Campus. Our road impact fee projects, finishing those up, $529,000. The $650,000 for the drainage project. The $85,000 for the grant match we just received. And then, of course, our transfers out, and that's really for debt service that we're using to pay the town's debt service right there. So all in all, we've dipped into our reserves this year. We had almost $6.5 million in revenue and a little over that in expenses. So we actually dipped down about $92,000, and that was planned. We knew this was coming. We knew in the capital improvement fund that we were actually going to dip and then take off from here. Now, next year, if everything goes as planned, we're going to have an excess of about $150,000. And I see this trend continuing and that fund balance to continue to grow. So there is some dollars available that we can use for capital improvements that when you get through your strategic planning and all that, you guys can talk about. But there's a little money here, and this fund seems to be growing at a relatively good clip. So the Water Enterprise Fund. We projected a net loss last year of $280,000. To be honest with you, the utilities department continues to really impress me on how well they manage their dollars. And so we're only going to have a net loss of about $106,000. I'm continuing to transfer money from the Capital Improvement Fund over here because once we acquire the Prescott Water System, we still need to build the water fund's reserve prior to us starting to pay back the general fund. Right. And so I thought, you know, we budgeted for it, let's put it there. We know how much it is, and when we get to that point where I can come to council and say, okay, now let's start paying back the general fund, we can make a plan to do that. And the same thing with this year, I went ahead and left it at $150,000 just to be safe, but we're looking at an operating loss of $92,000 next year in the water plant. Now, this is just taking the revenues from customers less the expenses and the debt service. So no depreciation, nothing like that. It's just a pure dollar loss. The number one project that I emphasize with council, the Prescott Water acquisition, and we've run estimates there, and that'll turn that $92,000 red number into a black number very, very quickly. So I highly recommend it that we proceed with that project. The Sewer Enterprise Fund, and maybe the Sewer Enterprise could be the example of how well these acquisitions did work. We were projecting a loss of about $249,000. It's actually going to be about $256,000. But now that we have we're operating the wastewater treatment plant, next year we're only projecting a loss of $70,000. Mm-hmm. And that includes a position for about that amount sitting there. So it's really, if we don't hire the position, we're going to be right at break even. And as you know, Mayor and Council, how conservatively we estimate revenues and expenses, mm-hmm. there's a high likelihood that that's going to be a positive number next year, yeah. 1 year after acquiring the wastewater treatment Good. Plant. So it's a, it was a smart financial decision for you guys to make. And again, I have that $500,000 project for Marley Ray. And really, that's all I have this evening, unless there's any other questions. We'll have the updated budget, which is, this guy will be on the website tomorrow morning. Yeah. For you all to look at, and also I have the updated revenue manual out there too.
Cool. Thank you. Any questions for Mr. Duffy?
No.
Okay. Thank you. And thanks for taking time with me when I come to your office and ask you questions on this.
No problem, sir.
All right. Thank you. The chair would entertain a motion.
Motion to approve resolution number 15-1059, adopting the tentative budget and proposed expenditure limitation for FY 2015-2016 in an amount of $23,937,400.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Moving on to item C, continued from March 10th, 2015. Consideration and possible action to appoint applicants to fill vacancies on the Planning and Zoning Commission, Parks and Recreation Advisory Board, Public Safety Retirement Board, Industrial Development Authority, and Municipal Property Corporation. We have Ms. Lewis listed as giving this, but okay, she's going to do it, and then you'll follow. All right. Whenever you're available.
Okay. Usually, our chairperson does this.
Please speak into your mic, if you will. Thank you.
I thought our vice mayor would do this, because usually
he does. Well, I'll go ahead and do it, then.
If you're doesn't matter to me.
No, I can do it.
I just didn't take the paper out, because you always do it.
Not a problem. Okay. We had the appointments committee met. We went through the selection process, and we have recommended the council appoint the following persons to the corresponding public body. Planning and Zoning Commission appoint Annie Lane for a term to 1/31/17, Michael Bacon to 1/31/16, and Claude Baker as an alternate. Parks and Recreation Advisory Committee appoint Daryl Jevons to a term ending June 30, 2015. Public Safety Retirement Board reappoint Cheryl Romley to a term ending June 30, 2016. Industrial Development Authority appoint John Comer to term ending June 30, 2017. And Municipal Property Corporation reappoint John Comer to a term ending June 30, 2017. Those are the recommendations we make to the town council.
Okay, thank you. Did we have any discussion among council? All right, the chair would entertain a motion.
I make a motion that we approve those appointments that are recommended by the appointment committee.
Second it.
Motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Next item is item D, consideration and possible action to direct staff in regards to the placement of the Granite Mountain Hotshots Memorial. Ms. Mayday, I believe, has a presentation.
Actually, I don't have much to add to what was in the staff brief. Mm-hmm. As you know, probably remember, we've discussed this before, and Mr. Nietzschman has taken some time to go look at some alternate sites, and still would like to come back and talk to council about the town hall site. So,
and I wanted to, excuse me for just a second, you all got the addendum to your packet with the letter from Mr. Nietzschman. Okay, thank you. Were you going to let Mr. Nietzschman speak then?
Sure.
Okay. Yes, sir. Klaus?
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, council members. Last time I was here in September,
And at the time, it was suggested to me that we should look at alternative placements for our monument instead of in front of the town hall. I've gone back to our organization. We have discussed it at length. And there was two alternate placements that were suggested, Memory Park and the Community Center. In view of the fact that our main points that we consider necessary would be visibility and accessibility. Both the Community Center and the Memory Park do not have the visibility that we think is necessary, and therefore they will not work for us. So we are, again, we're asking the council to give us a spot in front of the town hall. We'll be happy to give you that monument. We'll pay for it. It'll be yours. And we're asking for your vote and your support. That's all I have.
Okay.
Unless you have questions.
All right. Did anyone have any questions for Mr. Nietzschman? No? Okay. Mr. Nietzschman and I, you and I spoke here.
Yes.
Maybe a month and a half, 2 months ago. It's been a little bit. And I expressed to you my thoughts on it.
Of course.
I had not wanted you to be surprised, okay? So, and thank you for being being up front with me. Our council will discuss for a moment, and then if we have any questions for you, we'll give you a shout. Okay, thank you. When I spoke with Mr. Nietzschman, I told him that my thoughts were Memory Park is the designation that the town is, or the location that the town has set aside for memorials, such as this firefighters memorial. I felt that town hall was the center for government rather than for memorials, but I told him it was up to the town council. You guys. He wanted a higher visibility. I felt that if it was set up at Memory Park, folks would have a place where they could park, which would be off of the highway, rather than trying to turn into the town hall to stop and look at it. It'd be off the highway. It'd be someplace where they could spend time at it, rather than out between the highway and the town hall building. But it's up to you folks. Share your thoughts, please. And then after a minute, I'm going to ask for public input. So if you have any thoughts, please share. Yes, sir.
Well, I understand the idea of the visibility being next to the highway. And you're referring to this more as a monument than a memorial. My only concern here is exactly that, the ability for people to get off the road, park, mill around and enjoy it, where I think that even though the visibility isn't good at the parks, you know, gives a little better opportunity for that.
Well, the visibility obviously is there when people drive up and down the highway and see the monument. The accessibility is the town parking lot, which would be available at least 3 days a week when the town administration is not open. We have planned two benches that face the monument with the back to the highway. So people can drive in, park in the back, walk out front, we'll extend the walkway. They can sit on the bench, we can look at this thing, they can think about it, contemplate it, pray, whatever they want. And so, again, we have the visibility from the highway, and we have the accessibility because of the parking lot and the driveway. And my Memory Park is accessible, but it's only really visible for the local people and nobody else. And that's not what I have in mind.
Okay.
Okay. And, you know, with that in mind, you folks are the ones putting this together and bringing this to the community.
I'm sorry?
I said you folks are the ones bringing this to the community.
Yes.
And with that in mind, if your group feels, the Elks feel strongly about it being here rather than elsewhere, I personally don't have a problem with it.
Okay. We feel very strongly about this particular placement.
You
Yes, ma'am. Ms.
One of the shortcomings of having it at either Memory Park or the other park is the inaccessibility to the people driving down the road, the highway, the main highway. The Granite Mountain Hotshots are not just Chino Valley. They are Prescott. They are the state of Arizona. They are national. The Hotshots were out of state fighting fires before they came to the Yarnell fire. The picture that is up here on the screen now, I took a t-shirt and the information from the service that we went to, mm-hmm. the memorial service, and gave it to Captain Brandon Rugsiger. Mm-hmm. And then about a month later, I got this note. Mrs. McKee, I took the liberty of having a tribute, a memorial made from the copies of the literature you sent to me about the tragedy involving the Granite Mountain Hotshot crew and the 19 firefighters who gave the ultimate sacrifice. I thank you very much for sending the items to me and hope that this is a just tribute. I encourage you to zoom in on the picture and tell me what you think. The tribute hangs in the classroom at the Lyndon Peters Fire District. The classroom is used not only by the firefighters, but it is used daily by the Lyndon High School ROP fire science class. I hope that each student is able to see it and appreciate the firefighters on each on their time there. Thank you, Brandon Rugsiger, Captain. And I went back to Lyndon and went to see it, and that was the first picture. I was there with him, with the mm-hmm. captain, and it gave me chills. It was very, very touching. These firefighters are to be memorialized by everybody, not mm-hmm. just people from Chino Valley, and I think the town hall is the best place.
Okay, great. And that's why we're having this discussion, right. is whether to have it on Highway 89 or to have it at Memory Park or one of the other parks. Yes, sir.
Robert, town manager? What's the town have to do to put this monument wherever they put it? We're at one of the parks or at town hall?
We'd process it through staff, through the development services and the technical review committee process, just like any other project. There just wouldn't be fees or anything associated with the application. And somebody's got to vet it for, you know, the foundation and safety and dealing with traffic and parking and people, and that's what our staff would be doing.
Okay. All right. Yes, sir.
I wondered if it was at one of our parks, wouldn't there be a sign on the highway notifying where the park, where the monument is? ADOT's pretty good about identifying other things that are a little bit off the highway, but to go ahead and get recognition for them. Mm-hmm.
But we could definitely approach ADOT about getting a blue sign. The town also has the ability on its own property to provide directions like that if it's useful.
Okay. Any thoughts? All right. Thank you, Mr. Nietzschman. I'm going to open it up now to the public. Did anyone from the public wish to comment on the location of the hotshot statue? Do we have a picture of it that we can put up there right now? Is there one? Ms. McKee, did you have a picture of the monument itself? Okay. Anyway, it's a monument that Mr. Nietzschman was building.
I have something to say.
Yes, ma'am.
Sorry.
Okay. Out of the woodwork.
All right.
Just so you guys do know, there already isn't a plaque at Town Hall, in front of the library, mm-hmm. in front of the flagpole.
Mm-hmm.
It was placed there over a year and a half ago.
Yes, ma'am.
In front of it. So there already is a plaque there at Memory Park for them.
Yes, ma'am. There's one at the flagpole. There's another one in the park itself. There's numerous ones all over the Quad City area.
Right. Oh.
Yes, ma'am. I was all right. Thank you. Yeah, I remember seeing you at that dedication. So, all right. Thank you. No, the, as I indicated, there's numerous statues and memorials around the Quad City area, and this is not a question of whether we want to honor the firefighters or not. It's a question of where do we put a memorial that'll have adequate parking, that'll have adequate access, that'll have safe access to it. Anyway, any others from the audience? Yes, ma'am. You have to come up.
We don't have a voting action on that. It's a discussion.
Mm-hmm. Simply. Yes.
How tall is the memorial?
It's about 5 feet, is it not? Mr.
76 inches tall on the base, that's 3 foot tall.
Okay.
It's going to be a pretty good sized statue.
Okay, pretty good sized.
9 feet.
Yes. How wide is it, Mr. Nishman?
About 5 foot wide. I have a miniature version of an art that I showed you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Get it? So you can.
My question is just a matter of driving concern.
Mm-hmm. With all right. Right.
Much less with it being in front of town hall, would it be?
Yes, ma'am. And that's one of the questions that I've had in mind is having folks slow down to look at it on the highway,
right,
rather than turning out. How we're going to address that, I'm not sure. Okay. If they do put it between the town hall and the highway. And that's something that our council needs to consider. Yes, sir.
Now I do have a question. Would it be any worse than people looking at it than the bulls and the camels and the whatever's down the road a little bit?
Ah, yes, the bulls and the camels. Yeah, we have numerous statues in the Quad City area. Yes, sir. And I suppose there's been a few folks wander through the roundabout looking at the horses. I followed a guy one evening that sort of straightened the roundabout out. Yes, sir. Any other comments from our public? Okay. If there's no further thoughts from our public, we do not have this on as an action item. It's simply a discussion item. But we wanted to have Mr. Nietzschman give him the opportunity to reconsider alternative locations. We wanted him to hear from our public as well as from our council.
Mr. Mayor, if you'd like, we could bring this back on the next agenda for a vote, for an action item.
Okay, let's do it on a vote then.
Yeah, okay. Mr. Mayor, can you have all the information we need vetted and available to us? Also size, what
sure.
It would take to put it there in both places?
So like foundation plans?
Foundation plans and in both places.
Sure.
Okay. Not only, but at here and also at Memory Park. And where it would be located and.
Okay, sure.
How they would have, if people drove in, how would they have access to it? Would they have to, do we have a sidewalk to walk down or,
yeah.
And maybe that's an issue. I don't know. But
okay.
I'd like to have more information.
Sure.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. All right. Continuing onward to item E, consideration and possible action to award the Community Development Block Grant paving project of portions of Chino Meadows Unit 5 to Fan Contracting Incorporated per one of the following two options. An amount not to exceed $265,500, excluding Lazy Loop and a portion of Cottonwood Drive due to budget limitations, or number two, an amount not to exceed $315,995 and authorize staff to move $50,495 from the current fiscal year contingency line item to the grants line item for this project. And Mr. Gripman, you'll be speaking in a moment. Mr. Wojcik?
I would like a ruling from the town council as to whether or not I'm allowed to get involved and vote on this particular subject, because I live on Lazy Loop Lane.
Mm-hmm. It wouldn't
drive,
be,
excuse me, drive.
Wouldn't be the council. Miss Smiley, are you available? Did you hear Mr. Wojcik's request?
Yes, Mayor, I did. I would say that because the council rules, I think the determination of a conflict of interest is up to the particular member. In this matter, you live on the...
Excluded.
I'm sorry?
Excluded. I live on the excluded street.
You live on the excluded street. So the first question is, do you have a pecuniary interest? Do you have something of value to gain or lose by the decision of the council?
That basically is my question to you.
Well, I don't know your situation. I don't know whether or not the paving of the street is going to, or the not paving of your street is going to be of benefit financially to you or a member of your family. The other consideration is that the council code of ethics has a higher standard, the standard of appearance of or an actual conflict. So if you're looking at an appearance of a conflict, yes, you may.
Yes, I may.
Yes, you may have an appearance of a conflict.
That sounds like a typical lawyer's reply.
Well, you're putting me on the spot.
I understand, and that's exactly what, because I don't want somebody coming back and firing me like they do on this Planning and Zoning Board.
Well, as an elected official, only the public who elected you can fire you.
Well, have you read the paper lately? There's a recall coming up quickly.
I'm not a political person. I give legal advice. My legal advice is, do you have a pecuniary interest? If you have a pecuniary interest, which I can't determine for you, because it's you who has to make that decision. If you have a pecuniary interest, then you go forward and you make your determination as to whether or not that constitutes a conflict.
Would it not be safe to assume that paving the roads in front of my house would be an improvement in value come time for resale?
Well, is that speculation? Because if it's a it has to be an actual value. So speculating that, yeah, maybe it'll affect the value of my house and maybe I'll go to sell it in 20 years or maybe I'll never sell it. You know, I'm not a good speculator.
You don't play the market.
No, I buy only mutual funds.
You're smart, in the last couple of weeks especially. Does anybody in the council have an opinion as to whether or not the remainder of the council thinks I should recuse myself or whatever?
I would offer that in times past when council members had the appearance or felt that they had an appearance of a conflict of interest, most of us have recused ourselves for similar situations. Matter of fact, some of them have been so remote as to have the town attorney say, you didn't have to recuse yourself, and yet we did. So,
okay, question is, do I have to go and sit in the audience, or can I stay here and just be quiet? What is your option?
I would tend, if you were going to recuse yourself, I would tend to think you should move to the audience.
Yes. Okay. Here I go.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Mr. Wojcik. Mr. Gritman, I believe you have a presentation for
us. I do. A small explanation of what this project is. As you know, this is using community development block grant monies. These are federal dollars. As a result, there are a lot of strings that go on to utilizing these dollars. For example, the neighborhood has to qualify as low to moderate income. The solution that whatever we propose as the project, has to have a 20-year lifespan. So Cecilia did the entire canvassing of the properties, all the properties that are involved in the project, did find that I think it was 52 or 58% of the people were low to moderate income, so it qualifies. And by paving rather than a chip seal surface, we qualify as a 20-year solution, if you will. So because of the types of monies that we're using, and as you know, we don't pave a whole lot in Chino Valley. Most of what we do is chip seal, which is about a 7 to 10, maybe 12-year life cycle. A roadway like this will easily last 20 years. What we did for the project, the town over the last several years, even after the Chino Meadows sewer project, we have been building AB base in this area for a number of years. Prior to this project, HERF Public Works crews actually brought in 4 inches of additional AB to make sure that we've covered all the manholes, everything is set ready for the contractor to go. What we're doing by using other pots of money for this is maximizing the amount of pavement we're putting on the ground. All that is included in this project is the contractor paving and raising manholes, and that's it. There's nothing else in there for them. I mean, there's mobilization, but there's nothing else as far as the contract goes. So what we did, we tried to, but I'm going to use the arrow here so it shows up on everybody at home who's watching this on television. The area down here known as the base bid is what is that green? Looks like yellow to me, but I'm going to call that green because that's what I believe the rest of the world sees. Green and blue, that is the base bid. The alternate bid that you see in the bid schedule, in the results of the bid, is this area up in red. We did it this way knowing that we, in all likelihood, we weren't going to get everything paved, but we wanted to at least create a project large enough that if for some reason somebody had asphalt to give away that they were going to give us a smoking price on, we could at least create that ability. Mm-hmm. Obviously, that did not work out. What we the contractors did bid is for the base bid down here, the total, the fan contracting was the low bid. The area in green and blue is $395,000. I'm sorry, $315,995. However, all we have in the grant is $264,000. So we started looking at how can we cut the project back to fall within the limitations of the budget. As you know, recently staff has been criticized for possibly exceeding approved amounts. So we wanted to make sure that we created an alternative that would stay within the confines of the grant itself. In doing so, we tried to get between pavement to pavement. So what I mean is that down here on Cottonwood Lane, down here from Grasshopper, which is right here, down to Center Street, all of these side streets are all paved. Well, they're all surfaced with chip seal. Therefore, by paving this area in here, we are providing continuity from a paved surface to a paved surface. Mm-hmm. Same thing holds to paving Center Street, Railroad, and Sunset all the way around to Porcupine Pass. Porcupine Pass is surfaced. Center Street is also surfaced with the new chip seal program we just did last week. So that roadway right there provides connectivity. So we looked at, do we either drop out this road or do we drop out Lazy Loop? If we drop out the northern road, we end up coming in well under the amount of the grant, and we don't spend the full amount of the grant. Again, our goal is to maximize free monies that we get. So the recommendation, what we have created here, is to drop Lazy Loop and this portion of Cottonwood from Porcupine Pass South, and leave those as dirt roads. We get this grant every 4 years. We will put those roads in the next cycle 4 years from now. There is some community factions that are interested in getting these two roads paved. So what we did was we created an alternative. You've heard Joe say that we have monies in contingencies. We are coming up towards the end of this budget year. We don't foresee any imminent catastrophic events happening in the next 5 weeks. So we have created an alternative here that should the council choose to go ahead and pave the entire base project, we can award it at the $315,000 by moving $50,000 over from contingencies into the project. And it goes into the grants fund because that's where the project is located in our budget. So with that, I'll answer any questions.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any questions for Mr. Gritman? I was asked by the vice mayor earlier to open this up to the public so we can have discussion after the public has spoken, unless you have questions for Mr. Gritman.
No. Well, I just have one question for you before you leave.
If we don't do this, the cost of coming back and doing it next year or next cycle, it's still going to cost more than $50,000.
Well, we'll have to go through the whole bidding process all over again, and we'll have to create a set of plans. Yeah, it'll be over $50,000.
Right. So, I mean, actually, we're getting, by doing it for $50,000, we're getting a deal, a bargain.
Yes.
Because all the equipment's there, everything's there, so we're not having to re-engineer it, redo everything else.
Right. And I should say, Michael actually, our new engineer, Michael actually engineered this in-house. So we didn't spend any money on it, on any outside engineering. This was all done in-house. So those would all have to be recreated again if we were to do as a second project in the coming years. Where we're going to get the $50,000 from is going to be the $64,000 question, because you saw the budgets. Next year, we're going from $175,000 to $155,000. So our road materials budget is dwindling. Those of you who drive Road 2 North in front of Safeway and the post office, that road is going to need some serious attention here relatively soon. And it's going to be an expensive road. Mm-hmm. You're going to have to weigh those types of roads that carry a tremendous volume compared to something like this in the future. So if you're going to do it, now is the time.
Thank you.
Okay. Yes, sir.
What would be your budgetary estimate of doing those roads in the process that we do the rest of them in a chip seal?
A chip seal runs about $55,000 per mile. These two roads coupled together are probably about a half a mile. So you're looking at probably $25,000 to $30,000 price tag, somewhere in there, mm-hmm. if you were to come back and do chip seal with town funds at a later date.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
But we won't be able to use the grant funds with chip seal. Is that my understanding?
No, if you were to do that, what I heard Councilmember Turner's question is basically award under the staff's recommendation for the 265, which is the grant amount, and then come back through our chip seal program and council direct staff to pave surface these other two streets in chip seal rather than pavement. So we would fulfill the grant obligations. Was that was your question, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, you're fulfilling the grant obligations to do everything in green.
Right.
And then we have these two locations that aren't going to have anything right now. There, again, everything else in town is chip seal. I'm just asking, you know, what is the dollar amount, roughly, to go in and chip seal them?
And I do want to bring that to everybody's attention here. This is the first paving project that this town has done in a long, long time. The square yard unit price that FAN has given us is $12 per square yard to pave the roads that you see in green. When we do a chip seal program, it's about $3.60 per square yard. There's that much of a difference between pavement versus chip seal, but you get 20-plus years versus 7 to 12, somewhere in there. So we could do it as a chip seal program if the council would direct the staff in accordance with that, with the funds coming out of next year's road materials.
Mm-hmm. Well, what happens to the grant money?
The grant money will get spent on everything that you see in green.
Okay.
Okay. On page 114 of your packet, you can see the bids that came in, because I'm sure our audience is interested in the bids. I believe since these are in the packet, they should be public records, so yes. I should be able to read them. The bid base price is what we're looking at, correct, Mr. Gritman?
Yes.
Okay. Bid base?
Basically, the alternate is outside of our budget. To pave that northern section north of Sunset, FAN was at $105,000, and we're way short of that money.
You bet. But I wanted our audience to know that the bid prices, the bids that were offered, Cactus Asphalt for the base price was $350,482, Asphalt Paving and Supply $371,045, and FAN Contracting $315,995, in case you folks were interested in those. Or had questions about that. Any further questions for Mr. Gritman? Yes, ma'am.
You said the chip seal lasts 7 to 12 years. Mm-hmm. Okay. On a highly traveled road, it would last less time, but being that these are two small areas that wouldn't get a lot of traffic, would last a longer period of time, correct?
Actually, no. Why a chip seal road degrades, you know, there's no good sciences behind it, because it's such a low level of engineering. Very few towns do what we do here. For example, when we finished the Chino Meadows project, the sewer project, we chip sealed the entire neighborhood, and yet Center Street, the far south end, right down in this vicinity, right in here, was some of the worst area of the chip seal that all went down at the exact same time. Other areas that have seen larger volumes of traffic are holding up quite well. So, no, I'm not going to say, I'm just going to say generally, as a rule of thumb, we paved those in 2008. It's 2015. There's your 7 years, and we've lost some of the roads already. That's why we rechipped Center Street as it is. In the next five, you can anticipate losing a significant amount of the remaining roads. You won't lose all of them, but a significant amount of them are going to start to go downhill very, very quickly. So that's what I mean by a 7 to 12 year cycle.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions from council?
Yes, sir. You know, I'd rather see us pave so it'll last longer, and I'd rather see do the entire thing in paving and use that $50,000 contingency fund. That's my personal choice. Okay.
Excellent. Thank
that's
you.
Why we put it on there.
If you would, grab a seat, Mr. Gritman. Anyone from the audience wish to address this issue? No? Okay. Discussion amongst council. When I spoke with Mr. Gritman regarding this project, I told him I was not overly enthused about the thought of using the $50,000 contingency funds. If it's the council's pleasure that we do so, since the equipment's already there and it'll finish that loop, you folks speak your minds on it. Like I said, I would rather save that $50,000 contingency for something else. But, yes, sir.
Well, I think it would be wonderful to do it, as Councilor or Vice Mayor Croft is saying, but with so many roads in our community needing repair, if we can do twice as much road with chip seal at this point in time, every other road that isn't dirt is chip seal. I can't justify spending the money on this little bit more of asphalt.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Ma'am? Okay. Mr. Best, do you have any thoughts?
No, I'm fine with the idea of getting the most bang for our buck.
Okay. Cool enough. Cool enough. Well, the chair would entertain a motion, and since it sounds like we're a divided council, we'll have a voice vote on or roll call vote.
I'm going to make a motion to consider impossible action to award a community development block grant paving project of portion of Chino Meadows Unit 5 to Fan Contracting Incorporated for one of the following options: an amount not to exceed $265,000, excluding Lazy Loop or a portion of Cotton Drive due to budget limitations.
Okay, so this is the one excluding Lazy Loop and a portion of Cottonwood Drive. We have a motion. Do we have
second
a second?
It. Second.
Okay. Okay. We have a motion and 2 seconds. All in favor? Well, we'll have a roll call vote on it. Ms. Lewis.
Councilmember McKee.
Okay. This is the option. Yes.
Option one.
No.
Option one.
Right.
For the grant money only.
For the grant money only.
The $265,000, not the extra.
That's okay. That's. Is that a yes or no?
Yes.
If that's what
the
you
motion was on option
yes.
one.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Councilmember Turner.
Yay.
All right. Councilmember Best.
Yay.
Vice Mayor Croft.
I'll go with the group. Yes.
And Mayor Marley.
Yay. Okay.
5-0.
It passes.
Okay.
We don't have an executive session scheduled this evening. Who has not moved to adjourn in a long time? Ms. McKee?
Move to adjourn.
Okay. Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Thank you.